Thank you, Lindsay. We are moving into 1 Corinthians chapter 13. So if you want to open your Bibles, that's where we're going to be spending most of our time this morning. I've got slides to help with some of the other scriptures I want to use this morning and add them as well. I realize that as we gather this morning, in our minds, one way or another, we're saying that the cultural context of our world is so much different than Paul's world. But I think we need to realize that the element that we're talking about this morning, agape love, is a crucial element to the church from the time that Jesus was on the cross. It actually put him there. It actually kept him there. To the very hour in which we live today. To the very hour in which we live today. This is a crucial element of Christ. Now, I really don't want to undo every wedding service I've ever done and included this scripture. But we need to realize that this is more than a wedding scripture. It's more than a scripture that's to be shared by couples. It's a scripture about Jesus. It's a scripture about us. And it's a scripture about something that we need to live into in these days and times. You see, Paul is using his discussion about agape to connect some dots in 1 Corinthians. If you go back to the first part, we were talking about no foundation, chapter 3. No other foundation can anyone lay than that which is already laid, which is in Christ Jesus. And so he's basically saying, guys, Jesus is the basis of all I'm going to say. He goes to chapter 9, he says, I'm willing to be anything to anyone to make sure that by doing so, I might save some. Chapter 9, 29. Now he comes to chapter 13 and he talks about agape. And he's preparing us for the chapters that are to come. Because in chapter 14, he's going to talk about worship. So basically, there we go. We've gone from a bigger message in chapter 10, just sort of scoping into the last several chapters. Chapter 10 was basically talking about the history that Paul is aware of and talking into the people. He's talking about choices that they've made. He's talking about the impact of disgrace in chapter 11. Basically, if you look at chapter 11, it's the impact of disgrace. Are you willing to disgrace Christ or not willing to disgrace Christ? He talks about hair an awful lot. So I guess he wants a lot of beauticians and barbers in the church. The other part of that chapter 11 is the holy meal, the Lord's Supper, and taking it with honor and not with disgrace. He's talking about spiritual gifts in chapter 12, and he basically divides it in such a way of saying, everybody's got these gifts, and this is how you should use these gifts. When we talk about the word agape, agape is a Greek word, and we don't use it. But I'm sort of wondering if we should start using it in the Christian church to talk about that unique love that is to be the glue of the community of faith. In other words, I'm sort of nudging us to talk about agape love. Because you can talk about loving a hamburger. I mean, really? And you can talk, on the other hand, I love Jesus. And it just doesn't measure up, folks. We should be able to approach our Christian brothers and sisters and say, I agape you. I said that to somebody a couple weeks ago and their eyes just got so big. In other words, it's a rare word. If you looked at all of Greek literature, it is rarely used in Greek literature. But when you look at the New Testament, agape is one of the most common words used over and over in the New Testament. No wonder it prepares us for chapter 14 when we start talking about worship. And Paul uses as a connector between what he's just talked about with gifts and what he's talking about in worship. In chapter 3, he says, eagerly, or 13, verse 1, he says, eagerly desire the greater gifts. And then he talks about these great gifts. He talks about these great gifts, about tongues of men and angels. Anybody know a tongue of angels? I mean, I hardly get through the English language. I can get a little bit of Spanish out, but very little, and very little Pennsylvania Dutch, praise the Lord. But these are the tongues of men. Can you imagine the tongues of angels? Being able to speak the tongues of angels? That's pretty cool stuff. Gifts of prophecy. Wouldn't it be sort of nice to know the future? Be able to talk about the future? Gifts of knowledge.
We can go to school for that, can't we?
Gifts of faith. Those individuals that we have stories of in our library who are able to continue to move forward with great faith. Gifts of generosity. People who have given their entire fortunes, their entire lives. The gift of sacrifice. That's pretty heady stuff. To think that agape is part of that. What's interesting then, it says, but if I don't have love, it's all for naught. Sacrifice without agape is meaningless. Even the deepest sacrifice of giving up our own bodies is meaningless without agape. Let's keep that in the back of our minds as we start talking about what is it. So what is this agape? Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It mirrors the fruits of the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit, it says in Galatians 5, 22, 23, is love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. What agape is not, is it's not envious, boastful, proud, rude, self-seeking, eagerly angered, recording of wrongs. It does not delight in evil, meaning unrighteousness, but rejoices in the truth. Agape love is eternal. It never fails. In verse 7 and 8, it says it always protects. Always is infinite. Always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. Where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. Those are all human things. But the reality is that all these things we can sort of get a handle on, and we're still sort of wondering what love is. We have a difficult time in our human context understanding agape. And the reason is that sin continues to turn us in on ourselves by its very nature. Sin turns us away from agape at every point. So Paul says everything else will go away over time. But you notice there's a lot of things in that list that we sort of want to keep around. Are we living beyond our present and into a future where agape is the gold standard? In fact, it's the only thing worth hanging on to. We realize that right now, we know in part. We prophesy in part. But when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. Now we see but a poor reflection in a mirror. Then we will see face to face. I know in part. then I shall fully know as I am fully known. Each highlighted part in that slide points out the human way that we interpret our world, that we interpret the world around us. Brothers and sisters, the agape love of Jesus Christ is only known and only as powerful in our lives as we are able to comprehend it. Agape love is only as powerful, only as known in our lives as we are humanly able to comprehend it. What I realize as I'm getting older is that the more my experiences are, the more able I'm to understand that history has an ironic way of repeating itself. So I want to know history now. When I was a kid in high school, I could care less about history. Anybody else say amen? But now that I'm old enough to see, wait a minute, that's what my grandpa was talking about. We have stories in our family about that kind of thing. It's coming back around again. I could learn from what happened back then for what's happening now. Take this COVID-19 thing going on. It was exactly 100 years ago that our nation went through a very similar pandemic. Ironically, it was affecting young people at that time, and this one is affecting our old people more, our elderly more. But the way they responded then, and the way they're responding now, the way we're responding now, it's history and becoming history. The same is true with understanding the love of Jesus, agape. Brothers and sisters, we can only share what we've experienced. I would nudge you a little bit to take time this afternoon and reflect on the love of Jesus in your life. Reflecting on the love of Jesus in your life will help you understand what Jesus is calling you to when he says agape. In 1 Corinthians 13 it says, "Now these three remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love." So what's so great about agape? What's so great about agape? I mean, why should the church even think about it? Why should we as Christians be focusing on it in the midst of so many other things that are taking our attention? We should be focusing on agape because of the one who gave it. In John 3:16, it says, "For God so agaped the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life." That shows God's love for us. In Romans chapter 5, verses 5 through 8, it says like this, "And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his agape into our hearts." Anybody's heart sort of warming up right now? "By the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us." You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for us, for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own agape for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. It is our privilege to know the agape
of God through His Son, Jesus Christ. And that becomes the model for which we are to love each other as brothers and sisters in the church. I mean, do you agape Jesus? That's the other side of the coin. We can talk all we want to about the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross. We can talk all we want to about how He went the extra mile to take care of our sin. But do we love Jesus back? And what evidence is there in our lives that we love Jesus? We can't go up and hug Him. Can you give Jesus a hug even in COVID-19? Oops. I missed a slide. Is John 13 in there? There we go. Thank you. A new command I give you, says Jesus. Agape one another as I have agaped you. So you must agape one another. By this, says Jesus, all men will know that you are my disciples if you agape one another. It's that sacrificial love that will go out the extra mile for someone else. And you say, give me another handle on this, Don, because I'm having a hard time figuring out what this is. So I'll go back to last week. I think all the men went out of the church saying, "Oh, dude, that was a great sermon," right? And the women sort of said, "Oh, my." Where's Ephesians 5? Thank you, Tyler. I'm glad you're right there. In Ephesians 5:25, Paul says this, "Husbands, agape your wives, just as Christ agaped the church and gave Himself up for her." Guys, we're allowed to be the example. We're allowed the privilege to be the teachers of agape love in our homes. It asks the wives to honor us. That's sort of cool, because we sort of know what that's all about. But us guys have the task of teaching our homes what agape is by the way we treat our wives, the mothers in our homes. That sacrificial, that going the extra mile kind of love that Jesus did. That getting in the way of danger, taking care of our families like Jesus did. That's the agape we can demonstrate in our homes. James Dobson talks so many times about how the home with a Christian man will grow in faith. A man who comes to church and brings his family has a better chance of that whole family understanding and knowing who Jesus Christ is as Lord and Savior and making their own individual decisions about following Jesus. The percentage is much higher than a home where mom grabs the kids and goes to church and dad stays at home or dad goes to golf. Just saying, you know, folks, we want some real-time understanding about this agape love. And the Bible gives us an opportunity to see it in real life and to do it in real life. It's interesting then that Paul moves on and follows and says, "Follow the way of love eagerly
and desire spiritual gifts, especially prophecy, as he heads into talking about worship in chapter 14. The bottom line is, brothers and sisters, Jesus still means for agape love to change lives, beginning with our own. And he means for us to so love each other and love into the world that we change the lives around us. That's the bottom line of gospel. And that's what we're giving the privilege to live into in these days and times. So many of us would just like a hug. I think of our elderly and those who are separated from their families because of COVID-19. And as I share this message this morning, they're on my heart. There's such a need for love today, even if it's just a hug. So I'd like to close this.